see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome to the It's in Queens podcast. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons. This is the only podcast that focuses on my borough of Queens, the borough with something for everyone. This podcast comes to you each week thanks to the Queens Tourism Council and the Queens Economic Development Corporation. Together, they present Queens as a destination complete with something for everyone, whether you live here, work here, or you just want to visit. We're now in the home stretch, sadly, of our summer break. I feel like my neighborhood is cleared out as everyone tries to squeeze in one last vacation and get out of town. But the benefit for me is that I really enjoy staycations over the summer, and in particular, being able to walk around the borough and the city, trying new restaurants, discovering new parks. And no matter where I go, I'm always armed with a book, no matter what. I grew up across the Hudson River in a suburban community where my local library was my home away from home, a respite. I would grab a bunch of books and sit there for hours, especially during the summer. I actually even remember how nice and cold, how cold and crisp it was inside thanks to the air conditioning. I would just dive into books for hours and get lost in them. Libraries and the roles they serve have changed over the decades. And that is incredibly evident when you step into any of the branches in Queens. The identity of each one reflects the neighborhood that it serves, and the services that the library system provides are much more comprehensive than what I had grown up with. It's not just about books, but about serving the communities and understanding their needs. And to better understand the scope and the services of the Queens Public Library System, I talked with Nick Buron for this week's episode. He was born and raised in Queens. He first joined the Queens Library System in 1993, and he has served as its chief librarian since 2016. In his job, he leads a 700-person team that's responsible for the library's collections, programming, outreach, and customer experience. So let's get to that interview. Nick Buron, welcome to the It's in Queens podcast.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Much appreciated. Happy to be here.
Let us get to know you first. You have been with the Queens Public Library System for 30 years. I cannot imagine being in a working for one place for 30 years. Talk about what this has meant to you and what you love most about your job.
Thank you very much. Yes, in 2 weeks, I will hit my 30th anniversary. I don't think, maybe some people do, but I don't think anyone goes into a job thinking, oh, I'll be here in 30 years. But, the Queens Public Library has been an excellent place to work since I started in 1993. And I think the ability to stay is the ability to have different jobs during that time. And so when I came in, I was a frontline librarian working in a relatively small branch, and I worked at many branches. And I took positions as an assistant manager, a manager, coordinator of teen services, assistant directors, worked at the central library. Every few years, moving up the ladder and taking on more responsibility. And for the last 7.5 years, since Dennis Walcott has been our president and CEO, I've been the chief librarian, where quite honestly, it's the best job I've ever had. So I think constantly engaging and investing in the library and the library investing in me has worked out to be a great opportunity for both of us.
And during this time, over the last 3 decades, talk a little about how you've witnessed the system evolve over the decades.
Absolutely. And so when I first came in, it was fairly that traditional library that we've come to see. We did have an online card catalog. So by that point, the old card catalogs with the files had pretty much already been gone by that point. But it was replaced by what was not necessarily the most, user-friendly interface of a computer that would find the books for you. And so more than ever, I think it was, I came in at a time where people really did come up to the desk to say, I'm looking for this book. I can't really find it on my own. And what has not changed is that interaction, where people come into the library needing something. They need a piece of information. They need a book. They need to register for English language classes. They're looking for a program. And, You know, I've told my staff over the last, 30 years that I've worked with colleagues and my staff that interaction, that positive experience that we can give people and be that public servant to find the resources that people come in for has been extremely important. Listen, it's hard for people to say, I don't know something. And every day we have our communities that come in and say, I need help. That's a very hard thing to say. And the best thing that we can do is to be able to provide that help and go home feeling like we have really made an impact in our community. So that has not changed. Technology, of course, it changes. You know, the role of programming has increased more than the necessity for a book, but books are still popular. In-print, e-resources, programmings are big. And the amount that the breadth of that the library has taken on in terms of responsibility has increased, and it has only made the libraries much more relevant.
And what's so interesting as you're speaking about this, I'm reflecting on my own experience growing up in the libraries, you know, that we grew up with are very different than the ones people step into now. They're more community centers with so much more, as you point out, than books. What's been one of the most inspiring things for you to watch as you've seen these changes?
Queens County, as a county of 2.4 million people, is a community that where almost 50% of the people that live in Queens were born outside the United States from, you know, way over 100 countries, speaking way over 100 different languages. That is incredible to be in such a unique place in the world where so many people come together and, quite honestly, relatively live in harmony. I mean, this is, and, you know, the library has really been the center of that. So when I see people come in and they say, my neighbors, you know, I just came in last week. I've immigrated from whatever country it is. And my neighbors told me, go to the library where you can learn English for free. Or you have things in this library that, you know, will help me. They don't say it like this, but that will help me see this library as my own. And, you know, that's why, you know, in all of our community libraries, really, they might be similar in some ways, but they're unique to their individual community. So when people come in for the first time into a library and they are warmly welcomed and see themselves in the library, and then they keep coming back, they start their American experience with our Queens Public Library. That is heartening, and I see that every single day.
I'm so glad you mentioned that, because I've seen a significant difference based on the libraries that I step into, such as the Flushing Library versus my home library here in Jackson Heights. I see a different flavor, you know, a different community, different resources. You know, that's something I don't necessarily see when I step. I won't target any other boroughs in New York City, but I see it more here in Queens. Just expand on that a little more, because I also noticed you have a very diverse staff. You also have translation services, so much more than, as you know, we grew up on just going to get books in the library. There's so much more services that you offer.
Well, basically, whatever the customer wants is something that we either are doing or it prompts us to tell us what we do need to do. A good example of that is what we see every morning when we open up our doors at the Central Library. There is a line right now outside the Central Library every day, Monday to Friday, with people who are newly arrived in the city. They're asylum seekers that are coming in, and they might be 100 people long in order to get the city-issued identification, ID-NYC, which is paramount to being able to get your first ID, you know, in the city, to be able to allow you to help register your kids for school, which is coming up in a couple of weeks, or to get a work permit. And it is a vital piece of information that people need to retrieve. The Central Library is one of the top places, one of the top 14 places in New York City to be able to get that. There is a line of people that are waiting to come in, having only been here for a few days. So a resource like that, where we can actually not only help them with the city-issued ID, but then welcome them into a place in their own language. Many of them are Spanish speakers. Many of them are French or Haitian Creole speakers. Some of them come all the way. I mean, I've seen Afghanistan refugees come in because they're finding their way. And the moment they can come into our location and feel welcomed, that is, like, there aren't that many places you know, that welcoming environment, whether it's for people who have just arrived or people who have been here for decades or have, you know, whose family has been here for generations. Where are those places anymore that are that center of community? And so I don't really see the library as that community center. I really don't like that term because I don't think it says enough about what we do. But when you say a center of community, that is what we do. And that's why you're talking about your library at Jackson Heights is a unique place for that community. The Flushing Library, you know, is so much bigger, and it is the busiest branch library in the country. And you can see it when you come in. And, you know, while we are doing similar, you know, activities in there, that sense of how can we help you in our community is paramount for those people that are working in there.
And in terms of connecting with the community, you know, what I'd love for you to talk about is how the library system also provides spaces for teens, because there was the recent announcement about a new teen center coming up in Long Island City and upgraded spaces for teens at other sites.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, you know, this is yet again an opportunity for us to be able to connect with our, you know, long-term customers. So teenagers have, you know, are super important to reach out to, because oftentimes we start losing teenagers. As someone who was the coordinator for teen services for a while, you see the pattern of young people really being involved, you know, in elementary and middle school, and maybe sort of flag off because libraries don't have exactly what they're looking for. This is a great opportunity. And thanks to the mayor, and, you know, in partnerships with other organizations, such as Best Buy and the Jolie Family Foundation, to really get money to give to all three library systems in New York City, because we are three different library systems in New York. There's the Queens Public Library, Brooklyn Public Library, and the New York Public Library. And we are unique in our own, but we are coming together in this initiative because we realized during the pandemic was hard on everyone. You know, we know that. But it was particularly hard on teens, who it is extremely important to keep connections, face-to-face connections. We actually found that they were some of the least likely people to be involved in a remote programming. Now you'd think, oh, teens, they always want to be online. But no, we were all teens. You need connections. And so these teen centers are really an opportunity not only to create connections with positive adults and positive staff members, but also to give them what they're looking for. So, and, you know, some of the things that they would be looking for would be, you know, the latest equipment and software so that they can engage them as well. Skill-based workshops that we can work with them with 3D printing and open lab times where they can come in. And like I said, I don't want to underestimate that, you know, teen mentors and teen center managers that are the positive adults that really are super important in teens' lives. You know, what do they say? It's like if a teen can find one person, one positive person to connect with, they are so much more likely to be successful as adults. And so really that's what we're setting up. And we do have, you know, we started a center in Long Island City and really built on what we had at Cambria Heights, at Flushing, at Central. And quite honestly, we learned a lot from doing this for years and years from our Far Rockaway Teen Library that we set up years ago, which is a unique standalone library that's open just to teenagers Monday to Friday.
And you know, you mentioned with a Flushing Library about how busy it is. For anyone who's not familiar with the vastness of the Queens Public Library system, can you talk a little about that? Because my sense is every time I go to the library, it's packed.
That is correct. So we have 66 locations, which means that we're about a mile away from almost every 2.4 million people in Queens. We are less than a mile away from almost every single one of those people. So that to us is very important that, you know, you can almost everyone can walk to their libraries as they're able or be able to get to their library by public transportation fairly quickly. We have, you know, a staff that really engages. And so we have millions and millions and millions of visitors a year. And it has, of course, you know, when we were all remote, you know, that dipped off a little bit. But I want to remind everyone that, like everybody else, the library shut down in March of 2020. By July of 2020, we were open. We started opening up, libraries for a grab and go service to at least be able to get your books. We had remote programming that had up to 70 programs a week. So we were constantly engaging when we were in that situation, but we weren't in that remote situation very long because we realized that in-person connections are what's needed. And that's what these teen centers do, and we've put them in areas where there are high concentrations of teens, and we scattered them throughout, the borough, so that, even those teens that aren't necessarily near these four centers, plus the Far Rockaway Center in Far Rockaway, really can have access to these locations. But these aren't the only locations too. We're not excluding other libraries that actually have pretty good teen areas as well, with engaged adults and staff members that can, help them with all the resources that they need.
And as we look ahead to this fall, what's on the horizon? Anything new? Like, tease something that's coming up over in the fall.
Well, that's very interesting. So it is the start of a new school year. And so we are here to help young people with their school. I've told people, whether it's teens or middle school, elementary school, that if you let us help you, you will do better in school. And so, we are always available to be able to help those that are, in primary school and secondary school, of course, in college as well, adult learners, we scan the gamut of, lifelong learners. So we are always there to help them. And September is always like the New Year's Day of, of a school year. It's like, it's a whole new year and it's a great time to, opportunity. But these teen centers are also an opportunity where we have youth justice courts that are taking place, where teens get to play the role of lawyers and defendants and be able to understand the justice process. We have college access so that as young people are approaching the college years where they can make smart, informed decisions, those smart decisions don't start in junior year of high school. By eighth grade, you really can start thinking about, there are some things to think about of how you plan out, how you're going to have a, better access to, the best schools that you can go to. And of course, we have, literacy services for those who, are looking to get their high school equivalency, because traditional schools are not necessarily for everyone. So we actually have, staff trained to be able to provide high school equivalency diplomas for those people that want to go a less traditional route.
And before I wrap up, I'm going to put you on the spot. You're going to tell me the last book you read or one of your most recent favorite reads. And I'm someone who reads a book a week. So, I've got my Viola Davis one that I'm midway through right now. Every week it's a different book. So what's your choice?
I'm glad that you asked, because I am currently reading a book called The Invention of the Restaurant. And its subtitle is Paris and the Modern Gastronomic Culture. And what it does is it talks about the rise of restaurants and how they took place in starting in Paris, that traditional restaurant that moved from the old inns and places where people would stop along the road to something where you would be able to go in at any time and be able to get a menu and be able to really go from that side of the road food to that gastronomic culture that we know of in Paris, France.
I will have to check that out.
It's Rebecca Sprang, because I can't give you information without being complete as a librarian.
Before I let you go, if our listeners want to learn more about the Queen's Public Library System, where should they go?
We have a vast amount of information on our website. That is always the best place to go, whether it's to learn about programs, books, even jobs that are available at the Queen's Public Library. It is www.queenslibrary.org. It couldn't be easier to get to us via the website or any of our locations.
Nick Buron, I want to thank you so much for appearing here today on the It's in Queens podcast.
Thank you very much, Jeff, for your time. Much appreciated, and I hope to see everyone at the library.
Keep an eye out. In the coming weeks, you'll hear about the opening of the new teen center in Long Island City and celebrations marking the upgrades of centers in Cambria Heights, Flushing, and at the Central Library. And each of the sites will be holding reopening events, including open houses that'll give teens an opportunity to see the updated spaces, meet the staff, and see the new tech equipment. There will be food, prizes, music, activities focused on the tech aspect like robotics, 3D printers, and circuits. And by the way, we talked about the website, but you should also know there is a fantastic app that puts all the resources of the library system at your fingertips. So make sure to check that out too. If you're looking for something else to do this month before the summer's over, well, we have you covered. That is where Rob McKay comes in. He is with the Queen's Tourism Council and the Queen's Economic Development Corporation, and each and every week, he highlights some of the more dynamic or interesting events that are happening across our borough.
Hi, Jeff. How are you? So glad to follow an interview up at the public library, which is one of my favorite things about Queens, because this weekend I'm proud to promote something else that is one of my favorite things about Queens, and that is the Beach Sessions Dance Series at Rockaway Beach. It starts, well, it's August 26th, which is a Saturday, and it starts more or less at 5:45 p.m. on the sand at Beach 108th Street. So if you go in at each, if you head towards the beach at Beach 108th Street, you'll be there. It's an outdoor dance performance. It's now in its ninth year. They've been great all the time. And this year, it's going to be two dances. One's a response to the other. Mercy Cunningham's Beach Birds will go first, and then Sarah Mitchelson's Response will go after. Mercy Cunningham is now 70 years old and one of the pioneering choreographers of the what's now called dance forms. They used to be called life forms. And this dance is great. And then the response is done by Sarah Mitchelson, who has been a choreographer here in New York since the early 1990s. And she is going to contemplate her own personal relationship with the dance Beach Birds in her response. So it's all just a wonderful, wonderful couple minutes of dance. And like I said, it's Saturday, August 26th off Beach 108th Street, starting about 5:45. It really is one of those things that just makes you so happy to live in Queens and so proud that that you listen to the It's in Queens podcast. All right, thanks. Bye.
Thanks, Rob. That is just a sample, just a few things that are happening in our borough. But if you want to find out everything else that's going on, well, the place to discover and explore all of that, everything that's on the horizon, is so easy to remember. It's at the It's in Queens website, and that website address is itsinqueens.com. And by the way, if you are more focused on business-related news, how to help your business, a family member's business, or a friend's business, well, then make a point to visit the Queens Economic Development Corporation's website at queensny.org. And when you're there, sign up for their newsletter. You'll get notified of everything that's going on right in your inbox. Now, if you visit one of the libraries in Queens, do us a big favor. When you visit any of the library branches, snap some photos, share them with us. Make sure to tag us on Instagram or Twitter and use the hashtag #ItsInQueens. Because who knows, your photo could become our photo of the week. Even, you know, you can even snap a photo of the book that you've picked up. I'd love to see that. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons. That's it for this week's It's in Queens podcast.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I babies cry.